Welcome everyone. In this lecture, we are going to see the satellite subsystems that for the previous lectures we have seen one of the satellite subsystem, that is attitude and orbital control system. Now we are going to see the another subsystem, which is the major subsystem, that is telemetry tracking, command and monitoring subsystem. The telemetry tracking and command system is essential to the successful operation of communication satellites. The main function of satellite management are to control the orbit and attitude of the satellite, monitor the status of all sensors and subsystems on the satellite, and switch on or off sections of the communication system. On large geostationary satellites, some repointing of the individual antennas is also possible under the command of the telemetry tracking and command systems. Tracking is performed primarily by the earth station antenna. So we are going to see here, this is the typical telemetry tracking and command monitoring systems. We can see here, this is the satellite, and through which this is the satellite telemetry tracking and command monitoring antenna. So we are transmitting the information from the controller. That controller will send some of the commands through the telecommand transmitter and antenna to the satellites. Now from the satellite, this telemetry tracking and command antenna will send the information to the satellite receiver antenna of the earth station. Now this will receive the signal and give to the telemetry receiver as well as to the tracking systems. So whatever is the data that will be received from the telemetry receiver will be processed by the data processor and also by the tracking system and given to the computer at the earth station for the attitude and orbital controls. Now this computer at the earth station will send some of the controls to the controller and also to the telecommand transmitter. Now once the data from this computer will send to the controller, controller will send commands to the telecommand transmitter as well as through this attitude orbital control, commands will be sent to the transmitter antenna, and hence again this will transmit the control commands to the satellite, and in this way we can control the operation at the satellite. So one by one we are going to see what is there in telemetry tracking, command and monitoring. The first section is telemetry and monitoring. The telemetry system at the satellite collects data from many sensors within the satellite and send them to the controlling earth station. As many as near about 100 or more sensors will be there on the satellite that will monitor pressure on the fuel tanks, voltages and currents in the power conditioning units, some critical voltage and currents in communication electronics, that is at the satellite site. Also it will monitor the temperature of subsystems and also some sensor data, status of subsystems, position of the switches and some of the sighting devices, and that all will be used for the attitude control. The telemetry data is usually transmitted by the FSK or PSK of the low power telemetry carrier using time division techniques. Low data rate is normally used to allow the earth station receiver to have a narrow bandwidth and thus maintain high carrier to noise ratio. An entire TDMA frame may contain some near about thousands of bits of data and take several seconds to transmit it. At the controlling earth station, computer can be used to monitor, store and decode the telemetry data so that the status of any sensor or system at the satellite can be determined by the controller on the earth station. The another system is the tracking system. The tracking system at the control earth station provides information about the three parameters, that may be range, elevation and azimuth angle of the satellite. So data from the velocity and acceleration sensors on the satellite can be used to establish the change in the orbit from the last known position by integrating the data. So Doppler shift observations at the control earth stations provides the data rate of range change in the satellite. So, active determination of range can be achieved by transmitting pulses to the satellite from the control earth station and measuring its round trip delay. The position of a satellite can be measured by triangulation from multiple earth stations. The position of a satellite can be determined within the 10 meter or range. So, ranging tones are used for range measurements and also can be used to millimeter accuracy. This is about the tracking. Another system into the telemetry tracking, command and monitoring is the command. A secure and effective command structure is vital to the successful launch and operation of any communication satellite. The command system makes changes the position and attitude of the satellite, controls antenna positioning and communication system configuration, and operates switches at the satellite. During launch, it is used to control the firing of the apogee kick motor and to spin up a spinner or extend the solar cells of a 3-axis stabilized satellites. The command structure must have safeguard against inadvertent operation of a control due to error. The control code is converted into a command word which is sent in a TDM file. After checking for validity in the satellite, the command word is sent back to the control earth station via the telemetry link where it is checked again. If it is received correctly, then an execute instruction is sent to the satellite so that the command is executed. The entire process may take 5 to 10 seconds, but it minimizes the risk of erroneous commands causing a satellite malfunction. The command and telemetry links are usually separated from the communication systems. Although they may operate in the same frequency band, that may be 6 and 4 GHz band, C band, two levels of command systems are used in the Intelsat satellites. The main system operates in the 6 GHz band in a gap between the communication channel frequencies, and the main telemetry system uses a similar gap in the 4 GHz band. So this is the telemetry tracking command and monitoring antennas we can see here for the 6 to 4 GHz systems on the satellite. This is the telemetry and command beacons. These are the antennas which will be on the spinner satellite. At the top of the spinner satellite, these are mounted and it will be used for the 6 to 4 GHz frequency band. So, we already have seen this. This is nothing but the what are the different components, equipments at the satellite that will be used here, or electronic equipments at the satellite end. These are that horn antennas. What is this? The telemetry and command beacons are the earth coverage horns. So the main system can be used only after correct attitude of the satellite is received. During the launch phase and injection into the geostationary orbit, the injection into geostationary orbit, the main telemetry tracking command and monitoring system may be inoperable because the satellite does not have correct attitude or has not extended its solar sails. So near about the omnidirectional antennas are used at either the ultra high frequency or S band that will be operating in the range of 2 to 4 GHz. For the backup system, the great deal of redundancy and sufficient margin in signal to noise ratio at the satellite receiver are allowed to guarantee control under the most adverse conditions. The backup system provides control of the apogee kick motor, the attitude control system and orbit control thrusters, the solar sail deployment mechanism if fitted, and power conditioning unit. It is also used to eject the satellite from the geostationary orbit and to switch off all transmitters after the end of life of the satellites, and that will be used for this purpose. The another subsystem is the power subsystem. So, power systems. All communication satellites obtain their electric power from solar cells, which convert incident sunlight into electrical energy. Some deep space planetary research spacecrafts have used thermonuclear generators to supply electrical power. But because of the danger to people on the Earth in case of launch fail and consequent nuclear spread, communication satellites have not used nuclear generators. Solar radiation falling on a satellite at geostationary orbit has an intensity of 1.39 kilowatt per meter square. The efficiency of solar cell is typically 20-25% at the beginning of life of the satellite, but falls with time due to aging of cells and etching of the surface by micrometer impacts. Since sufficient power must be available at the end of the life of the satellite to supply all the systems on board, about 15% extra area of solar cells is usually provided as an allowance for aging. A spin-stabilized satellite has a cylindrical body covered with solar cells. Because the cylindrical shape, half of the solar cells are not illuminated at all the time. And at the edges of the illuminated half, the low angle of incidence of sunlight results in little electric power being generated. Recently, a large communication satellite for direct broadcasting generates up to 6 kilowatt from solar power. A three-axis stabilized satellite can make better use of its solar cell areas than a spinner. Since solar cells can be rotated to maintain normal incidence of the sunlight to the cells. Only 1/3 of the total area of solar cells is needed relative to a spinner satellite, with some savings into the weight. With large arrays, a 3-axis stabilized satellite can have more than 10 kilowatt of power generated. In a 3-axis stabilized satellite, solar cells must be rotated by an electric motor once every 24 hours to keep the cells in full sunlight. This causes the cells to heat up, typically to 50 to 80 degrees Celsius, which causes a drop in output voltage. In a spinner design, the cells cool down when in shadow and run at 20 to 30 degrees Celsius, which somewhat higher efficiency than a 3-axis stabilized satellite. The satellite must carry batteries provide power during launch and eclipses. On geostationary orbit, eclipses occur during two periods per year, that is around the spring and fall equinox, with longest duration of about 70 minutes per day. To avoid the need for large, heavy batteries, a part of communication system load may be shut down during eclipse. But this technique is rarely used when telephony or data traffic is carried. However, TV broadcasting satellites will not carry sufficient battery capacity to supply their high power transmitters during eclipse and must shut down during the eclipse. By locating the satellites 20 degrees, which is equivalent to 1 hour and 20 minutes, west of the longitude of the service area, the eclipse will occur after 1 a.m. local time for the service area, when shutdown is more acceptable. Batteries are usually of the sealed nickel hydrogen type, which do not gas when charging and have good reliability and long life and can safely discharge to 70% of their capacity. Typical battery voltages are 20 to 50 volt with capacities of 20 to 100 ampere hours. So far for the satellite subsystems, we have seen the orbital and attitude and orbital control monitoring system, then telemetry tracking command and monitoring systems, and for after that power systems we have seen, and the another major system of the satellite is the communication subsystems. A communication satellite exists to provide a platform in a geostationary orbit for the relaying of voice and video and data communications. All other subsystems on the satellite exist to support the communication subsystems, although this may represent a small part of volume, weight and cost of the satellite.
the growth in capacity is well shown and for the inter-satellite systems. Downlink is most critical part in the design of a satellite communication systems. The satellite transmitter has limited power, and so that we have to use with the minimum resources, the downlink has to be designed. As link distance is again about 36,000 kilometer, the receiver power level is very small and rarely which exceeds 10 raised to minus 10 watt, that is near about minus 70 dB, even with a large aperture earth station antenna. For satisfactory performance, the signal power must exceed the power of the noise generated in the receiver by 5 to 25 dB depending on the bandwidth of the transmitted signal, which depends on the data rate also and modulation schemes that we have used for the transmission. With low power transmitters, narrow receiver bandwidths have to be used to maintain the required signal to noise ratios. Higher power transmitters and satellites with directional antennas enable wider bandwidths to be utilized, increasing the capacity of the satellite. In early communication satellites had transponders of 250 to 500 megahertz bandwidth but had low gain antennas and transmitters of 1 to 2 watt output power. When the full bandwidth was used, the earth station could not achieve an adequate signal to noise ratio because the system was power limited. Larger generations of communication satellites also have been power limited because they could not utilize the radio frequency bandwidth as efficiently as a terrestrial microwave communication system can use. Because at the terrestrial microwave communication systems, large number of resources we can utilize. So there are no limitations about the weight and other things like space. Their bandwidth utilization efficiency has been steadily improved. In high capacity satellites, their available bandwidths have been reused by employing several directional beams at the same frequency. That is for special frequency reuse and orthogonal polarization at the same frequency, polarization frequency reuse. Some satellites use multiple bands to obtain the more bandwidths. Again, we have to consider the international agreements which restrict the frequencies that may be used for particular services, and the regulations are administered by the appropriate agency in each country. The World Administrative Radio Conference makes decisions on changes in frequency allocation. The standard spacing between GEO satellites was originally 30, but under regulations covering North America and much of the rest of the world, the spacing has been reduced to 20. The move to 20 spacing opened up extra slots of new satellites in 6x4 and 14x11 GHz band, that is for 6x4 C band, and for Ku band it is 14 to 11 GHz frequencies. Narrower spacing for satellite requires earth stations to have narrower transmit beam antennas to avoid interference with adjacent satellites. Higher frequencies make narrower antenna beams and better control of coverage patterns possible. Satellite systems designed for Ku band, that is 14 to 11 GHz, and K band 30 to 20 GHz have narrower antenna beams and better control of coverage patterns than satellites using C band, that is at the range of 6 to 4 GHz. As the available orbital slots for GEO satellites have filled up with satellites using 6x4 and 14x11 GHz band, attentions are focused on the use of the 30 to 20 GHz band, which is very high frequencies. Originally, this band had 3 GHz bandwidth allocated to satellite services, but part of the band was reallocated to the land multipoint distribution services. Approximately 2 GHz of bandwidth is still available for satellite systems at K band on an exclusive or shared basis, which is equal to the combined allocation of C and Ku bands. However, Propagation in rain becomes a major factor at frequencies above 10 gigahertz. Attenuation in rain increases at roughly the square of the frequencies. So at 20 gigahertz, rain attenuation is 4 times larger in dB than 10 gigahertz. So this is all about the communication subsystems. Till now we have covered 4 types of subsystems, and the remaining is satellite antenna subsystems that we are going to see in the incoming lecture. Thank you.